the nervous hiccups have subsided, so I hope they stay that way. I guess thing that surprised me most about art talks is the incredible amount of honesty. I mean, there's nothing I can really imagine more scary and more wonderful than going up in front of all these people and sharing your own ideas. I feel like everyone here's had their little moment of clarity, which is something I definitely wait for with an increasing impatience. As I finish projects, I don't really feel a sense of finality or pride. Instead, I think I'm aware of a growing number of ideas on how to refine and kind of expand on my projects and carry them with me in the future. I think that grade 11 at ESA is definitely a year with huge responsibility. It's in this 9-month period we're supposed to kind of mass produce and radiate our own energy and create all these new things. And to be honest, I've done little of that. I spend most of my energy being angry about how I don't have enough energy and more time worried about making art than actually kind of trying to make it and put that energy in there. So it's weird because I know that without that outlet, I can't really function peacefully and I don't really have a way of making sense of the things I do and why I do them. I've been thinking a lot lately about the disconnect between doing the things that we love and being happy. Initially, I thought these things were definitely connected, non-existent without its twin, but I think I've changed my mind. Though it's obvious that doing the things we enjoy leads to happiness, I think that there's a flaw within the relationship that often goes unnoticed. The reward of happiness doesn't always follow these acts, and I think that's definitely very frustrating for me. I know that I love art. As cheesy as it sounds, it holds importance to me, and I try to do it as much as I can. But the longer I struggle with art, I think the more trouble I have to actually create finished product, which the process is important to me. I am goal-oriented, and this is quite important as well. I'm coming to terms with the fact that maybe doing the things I quote-unquote need to do, kind of delving further into my understanding of the world around me and how I kind of see it is painful. Painful, it sucks sometimes, but it's important, and I think it's more important than taking the easy way out and ignoring so much of what's around us. Last art talk, my friend Sienna said something that really stuck with me. Artists are braver than we credit them to be. Like I said, it's easy to ignore so much, just kind of remain at peace with what we see and how we see the world, even though this is often a distorted image. I believe now more than ever that art is something I need to keep doing. It acts as a lens, and it allows more perception and a higher level of kind of expression of the things I see around me. It's frustrating, it's confusing, but it also allows me to make peace with bigger flaws I see. So I've decided that maybe in this case, art is a way for me to make peace in that it kind of it creates tension and that it's confusing, but it also releases a form of tension because obviously it allows you to deal with things that you can't in another way. As an artist, non-material goals for first world citizens include happiness, success, and being both caring and cared for. These goals cannot be achieved without learning, which is the outcome of an often painful process of experience. I think that when our physical needs are met, we strive to grow as individuals and better ourselves to reach self-actualization, which is something we've been talking about in apps, which is really cool. And I really enjoy that because without the issues we go through, I don't think that we would continue to grow. In an ideal world where all our physical and emotional needs are met, I believe that we would stay in a static state of being, which is kind of useless because, I mean, we have all these great things. Why don't we put them to use? What I think I'm trying to articulate is the difficulty in balancing art and being happy is actually allowing me to create. And I'm trying to figure that out a little bit as the year goes on. As I mentioned, making actual physical art has been pretty slow for me this year. I've been working mostly in my sketchbooks, and I go through about 1 a month. And this next project I'm going to talk about kind of started in a sketchbook as a literary analysis between two pieces of work. One is Shampoo Planet by Douglas Coupland, and that kind of follows like this future-oriented young man who's very obsessed with everything that's modern, and he's kind of trying to leave all his memories behind. Whereas the second piece of literature is called Movements in Jars by Megan Jackson. It's a poetry book, and in this book, she kind of looks at the preservation of moments in time through small objects, physical objects. So, this project started out as a photography series in the fall. Basically, it turned into a sculpture. I liked the idea and I wanted to make it real. I used plastic to encase objects that have significance to my memory in jars of various sizes. The liquid is clear for the most part. It mimics water and a lot of the objects are floating, which I really like. Kind of gives a subconscious supernatural effect, and I'm really drawn to that for some reason. It's a pretty literal image, the actual physical preservation of an object, even though all of these don't actually need to be preserved. They look maybe something like you could find in a sketchy pantry or a biology lab of some sort. To me, this was the most obvious way to kind of show how important memories are and the trouble we go to actually preserve them. This object is meant to draw attention to the importance of objects and the memories we associate directly with them. These are actually objects that I've collected throughout my life, and I think there's definitely a disconnect between the viewer and the artist because I have memories to them that you may not understand, but I think you can kind of place yourselves in my shoes and kind of, I think everyone has objects like that, so. You know, I feel like the faster life moves, the more caught up we become in the future, and we forget not only the past, but also kind of refuse to immerse ourselves in the present, which is very detrimental, I think, in that we miss out a lot of what's happening. I've always been interested in memory, and I use it in a lot of my projects, the ones that actually get done. And I believe that small objects are the best way to show memory, and that they, you know, you can take them with you and they fit in your hand and they're small and they go unnoticed. Here's, so yeah, I don't know. I think that dwelling in smaller details has definitely offered not only a hope-inducing distraction from bigger things that are kind of harder for me to deal with and they're out of my control, but they also give me the chance to kind of honor my past and also, you know, be invested in it. And I think that lets you move on to the future in a more open-minded way. I don't know. I think that's about it. Thank you very much.